begin by bringing to us bands of marriage between Washera Ngonjiri and Klein Mwabadi, who will get married on the 3rd of August at Ndemi Place. At Ndemi Place, at 12 noon. Klein is a gentleman here recording. I believe we're invited. I think we're invited to the wedding on the 3rd of August. Please take note. Let's pray for the word of God. Eternal God, we worship you this morning and we thank you for you are a speaking God. We thank you, Lord, for your love for us. We thank you, Lord, for the fact that you know us and that you're interested in each one of us. And Lord, we submit ourselves to you even as we sit under your word. We pray that, Lord, you will indeed speak to us, for the entrance of your word brings life and light. That indeed, oh God, you will speak to our hearts, that you will be glorified. And Lord, I pray that the meditation of my heart and the words of my mouth will be acceptable to you. I surrender myself to you, Spirit of God, that you would use me as a vessel of honor for the benefit of your people and for the glory of your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So today we are continuing with our series on the call. The call to be fearless. The call to be faithful, the call to fight, and the call to finish well from the book of 2 Timothy. And Pastor Mark set a precedent for us last Sunday that I want us to follow today. I'd like us to please stand up as we read the word of God from the book of 2 Timothy, the whole of chapter 2. Says, you then, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. And the things you have heard me say in the presence of many witnesses, entrust to reliable men who will also be qualified to teach others. And your hardship with us like a good soldier of Christ Jesus. No one serving as a soldier gets involved in civilian affairs. He wants to please his commanding officer. Similarly, if anyone competes as an athlete, he does not receive the victor's crown until he competes according to the rules. The hard-working farmer should be the first to receive a share of the crops. Reflect on what I am saying, for the Lord will give you insight into all this. Remember Jesus Christ, raised from the dead, descended from David. This is my gospel, for which I am suffering, even to the point of being chained like a criminal. But God's word is not chained. Therefore, I endure everything for the sake of the elect, that they too may obtain the salvation that is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. Here is a trustworthy saying, if we died with him, we will also live with him. If we endure, we will also reign with him. If we disown him, he will also disown us. If we are faithless, he will remain faithful, for he cannot disown himself. Keep reminding them of these things. Warn them before God against quarreling about words. It is of no value and only ruins those who listen. Do your best to present yourself to God as one approved, a workman who does not need to be ashamed, and who correctly handles the word of truth. Avoid godless chatter, because those who indulge in it will become more and more ungodly. Their teaching will spread like gangrene, and among them are Hymenaeus and Philetus, who have wandered away from the truth. They say that the resurrection has already taken place, and they destroy the faith of some. Nevertheless, God's solid foundation stands firm, sealed with this inscription, the Lord knows those who are his. And everyone who confesses the name of the Lord must turn away from wickedness. In a large house there are articles not only of gold and silver, but also of wood and clay. Some are for noble purposes and some for ignoble. If a man cleanses himself from the latter, he will be an instrument for noble purposes, made holy and useful to the master and prepared to do any good work. Flee the evil desires of youth and pursue righteousness, faith, love, and peace, along with those who call on the Lord out of a pure heart. Don't have anything to do with foolish and stupid arguments, because you know they produce quarrels. A And the Lord's servant must not quarrel. Instead, he must be kind to everyone, able to teach, not resentful. Those who oppose him, he must gently instruct in the hope that God will grant them repentance, leading them to a knowledge of the truth, and that they will come to their senses and escape from the trap of the devil who has taken them captive to do his will. This is the word of the Lord. Amen. Last Sunday we looked at, please take your seats. We wouldn't want you standing for the next 40 minutes. Last Sunday we looked at the first chapter of 2 Timothy, which was an introduction to this letter. And we saw that the book of 2 Timothy was written by Paul the Apostle. You will excuse me, I have a really persistent cough, but it is defeated in Jesus' name.
Amen.
So Paul the Apostle is the writer of both books to Timothy, and he writes this book while still in prison, just before his death. And the reason that he writes this is to give final instructions to Timothy. 2 Timothy is known as the last words in many circles, as well as to encourage and strengthen Timothy, his dear son in the faith, to keep going. Now, Paul is an old man at this point. He has lived his life. He has preached the gospel. We know, most of us would know the story of his conversion, how he came from a very zealous Pharisee and teacher of the law to becoming a very zealous preacher of the word of God. He has done this since his conversion. He has preached the word of God. He has planted many churches. He has been faithful to the call that he received. And he has mentored many people along the way, including Timothy, whom he writes these letters to. We also saw that when Timothy began ministry, he was about 18 years old when he began pastoring a church in Ephesus. And Timothy is a young man of Jewish and Greek origin. He has his mother is Jewish, but his father is Greek. He has a godly heritage that he received from his mother and his maternal grandmother. He's a spiritual son to Paul, and he's a pastor, a young pastor at a very young age. And even though Paul knows, he's in prison, he said, and even though he knows that his time is almost up, he's just about to be executed, it's very interesting to note that he does not focus on himself. He does not write and say, hey, can you bring me more blankets? This Roman prison is very cold. Or can you make me my favorite soup? Or can you come and see me before I die? He's actually not concerned about himself. He does not focus on his own situation, but his concern, this old man who has walked with the Lord, is for the church. Isn't that amazing? That he's in a cold prison and he's thinking about the church. He's thinking about his spiritual son, Timothy. And Paul does this because he wants Timothy to be prepared. He does not want the people that he leaves behind, the new generation of preachers, to be unprepared for the task at hand. Paul knows very well what it is like to preach the gospel in a pagan setting, because the city that Timothy was a pastor of was a pagan city, the city of Ephesus. It was one of the major cities in the Roman Empire. It was a center for commerce, for politics, and all the religions that are going around at that time. It was actually the location for the temple of the goddess Artemis, or Diana. This church is also plagued by heresy and false teaching at the time that Timothy begins pastoring the church. There are many that have been mentioned. Last Sunday we talked about there was Hermogenes and Philetus. Today we've mentioned a few. There's another man called Alexandra who's mentioned elsewhere, who had broken off from the faith. They were of the faith, but they had broken off. And as if breaking off is not good, is not bad enough, they went on to propagate other doctrines. They left the church, but they were not quiet. They went on to propagate and to instigate false doctrines in the church of God. And so Timothy had such a big task ahead as a young man. And we've seen Paul's concerning that even in prison, he's aware of that. He's aware that there's this young man who has taken over this church. He's a young man. He's mature. He has received the call of God in his life, yes. But the setting in which he's pastoring is a very secular one. And then there's also now the false teachers all around him. And so Paul admonishes Timothy and reminds him. If you look through 1 Timothy, the main thrust there is Paul telling Timothy, keep away from false doctrine. Do away with these people. And even in the book of 2 Timothy, we looked at the encouragement to be fearless, because you can imagine it must be very scary for an 18-year-old pastor in a city where there are all sorts of gods being worshipped. There's so much godlessness. And so Paul tells Timothy, you must be fearless. And the other task that Timothy has is to correct wrong doctrine. This is the main thing that he has to do in this church in Ephesus. Correct wrong doctrine all around. Let them know what the word of God is. And so today we look at the call to be faithful. And Paul is encouraging Timothy from prison, from the prison walls, to remain passionate for Christ, to be faithful in discharging his duties as a minister, to remain firm and avoid ungodly beliefs and practices. And interestingly, is that just as it was then in Ephesus, so it is today, isn't it? We live in a day where we have heard that Christianity, Kenyans are 80% Christian. And that makes me wonder, how come you have so much moral decline? If 80% of the people in this nation are believers, don't you think there would be a difference? You know? In every sphere of this country. And somebody rightly said that Christianity in Africa is miles wide, but only an inch deep. And actually, John Stott at some point quoted one of the famous English writers, Piper, and he said that Christianity generally in all the world is 1,000 miles wide, but only half an inch, not even an inch, half an inch deep. And sadly, this is the predicament that we find ourselves in. Our times are not too different from the times that Timothy lived in. And this is not just in Kenya. It is a global problem. In Kenya, we're seeing churches mushrooming all over. And these are actually becoming booming businesses. There's one, a few months ago, somebody asked, hey, would you want to plant another church? This is a business person. And he was looking at investing, becoming a stakeholder. Because his business partner has actually invested in another side hustle, which happens to be a church. And so he was struggling to get the fact that, you know, a church is not a business. This is a believer, mark you. And he was very genuine when he said, hey, by the way, I'll put in the money, you know, the startup, I'll keep track of the giving. So it is such a sad thing, really. And I believe that it hurts the heart of God to see that the church is now a business. It's now an investment where people want to make money out of it. And it's also because the human heart is very gullible. Some of the richest people in this country and in America are pastors. Do you know that? But then what kind of pastors are they? That's the thing. Because if you stick to this and you preach this, you will not fall into it. It will be very hard for you to fall into that category. Christ is no longer preached on pulpits, as much as we have churches mushrooming all over. Prosperity, health, and wealth are the selling doctrines. Do you want to get well? Bring a tithe. The man of God will lay his hand on you, and you will be healed. And it shows the state of the human heart that we are very gullible, and unless we are strong and grounded and know God, we can easily be led astray. Praise the name of the Lord. Hence why Paul told Timothy, be careful, preach the doctrine. And the call for us today is to be faithful so that we too are not led astray. We need to be devoted, or we need to know God for ourselves. You know, we need to know the word of God so that we too are not led astray by all the false doctrines. The media seems to be waiting for a scandal that involves any church. And they don't seem to bring these pastors in good light. And you know, the sad thing is, once you read that paper, you see that story on the news, what people say is, look at these Christians. They lump us all together, which really is a shame. So you and I are called to be faithful to God. We are called to be faithful to what God has called us to do. For Timothy, the call was very clear. He was called to preach the gospel and to correct wrong doctrine. What is it that you have been called to, that you need to be faithful to? So we're going to look at 3 points on how we can be faithful to God in this day and age. The first thing is, we need to understand the commission and pass it on to others. We see this in verse 1 and 2 that says, you then, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. And the things you have heard me say in the presence of many witnesses, and trust reliable men who will also be qualified to teach others. And in the entire of chapter 2, Paul basically is reminding Timothy of the commission, what it is that Timothy has to fulfill, and that Timothy has to remain faithful to. We cannot remain faithful if we do not know what we're being faithful to. So what do you mean when you talk about faithfulness? We need to understand the commission, and we also need to pass it on. For Timothy, it was very clear that as a pastor in a secular city, he was to teach the word of God, and he was to correct wrong doctrine. And he had an enormous task ahead of him as a young man, because for you to teach the word of God, you have to study it. He had to know what God says so that he could then correct the wrong doctrine. Look at the word that Paul uses in verse 1, he says, be strong. In verse 3, join me in suffering. In verse 8, remember Jesus Christ. Verse 14, keep reminding God's people of these things. Verse 15, present yourself to God as one approved. Verse 16, avoid godless chatter. And in verse 22, flee the evil desires of youth. Basically, things that Timothy had to do. Because it is easy to teach faithfulness, it is easy, to teach the word of God. But what about yourself? And earlier on in 1 Timothy, Paul tells Timothy, watch your life and your doctrine. It is one thing to know proper doctrine and to teach it, but to apply it to yourself is another thing. And I think this is one of the problems that we're having, you know, when we talk about churches mushrooming and the pastors. You have pastors who know the word, they're teaching it, but then when you scan their personal lives, they're not really living it. And this call it was for Timothy as a young minister. But this morning, it is not just for pastors here. It is for every one of us. All these words that Paul uses are for each one of us. And the second thing that we see in verse 2, Paul says, the things that you have heard me say, entrust this to others. Do not keep it to yourself. Once you know what it is you're called to, let it not end with you. Timothy, do not let the gospel end with you. And Paul is not saying something that he does not do himself, because he had known the gospel, he had lived it, and even now as he's about to face his death, the gospel is not ending with him. He has mentored Timothy, he has mentored Titus and many others, he has worked with other people, he has poured himself into the lives of other people, and he's telling Timothy, this gospel that I have passed on to you, what you heard me preach in the presence of many witnesses, entrust it to others. Yes, you're young, you have a full life ahead of you, don't just keep it to yourself, pass it on. And it is the same for us. Whatever it is that God has called you to, if you're good at business, do not let that skill end with you. I'm challenged when I look at Asians and how they run their businesses. You find somebody has been in downtown Nairobi since 1970, in like a small shop, but they bring their sons on board, they mentor them on how to do business, so that when the man is old, man is gone, the shop does not. For years, Asian shops have been around and they are still going. And it is a sad thing that sometimes we hear of business tycoons who, once they are gone, what we have is not people fighting for what's my share. The business closes. That is such a shame. We need to pass it on. We need to pour ourselves into the lives of others. And so is it a skill? What is it that you can give to somebody else? Whether a younger person, even older people, what is it that you can give to somebody else? And I'd like to challenge the older people among us. You have a wealth of experience. You have lived longer than most of us. There are things that you have learned that we do not yet know. Please don't keep that to yourself. If it will help somebody, please pass it on. Find somebody that you can walk with. The older believers in the church are a big treasure because they have known God, they have walked with God, they have testimonies. Please find a younger person, and I don't mind you pulling me. I'm a young person. Come and give me your testimony. Come and tell me how it's been for you to walk with the Lord. Pass it on. Pass it on. When there's a relay race, you know, when people are passing on the baton, if it is dropped, or if the person who's supposed to hand it on decides, I'll hold on to it, you know, that's where the race ends. We have to pass it on. And it's interesting that this old man, Paul, in prison, is thinking about the future of the church. He's thinking about, well, I'm about to die, but there are things that these guys need to know that will keep them going. Pass it on. Tell your neighbor, pass it on.
Pass
And it's not just for the older ones among us. You know, the amazing thing is that Timothy was called to set an example in 1 Timothy to all age groups. It was not just, oh, well, find teenagers or find the youth in the church and set an example to them. And naturally, we expect that older people will set an example for the younger ones, isn't it? How much more amazing is it for a young man to set an example to even older people? So this is a challenge even to the younger ones in our ministry. You too can set an example. Praise the Lord. And you too can mentor somebody. Understand your commission. Praise the name of the Lord. And be willing to pass it on. Now the second thing that we see in the book of 2 Timothy chapter 2 is that after understanding your commission, we need to undertake the commission and we need to be willing to endure suffering. Once you know what it is that God has called you to do, then you need to go ahead and do it. We know that Timothy was shy and timid. He probably thought, I don't think I have what it takes to lead this church. I don't think I can become like you, Paul. You are known for your zeal. You wrote many letters to churches. You planted many churches. How can I match up to that? But we saw that Paul encourages him. He tells him, do not let anybody look down on you because you are young. God has not given us the spirit of timidity, but the spirit of power, love, and sound mind. Timothy, undertake the commission. You have been given the gift of God through the laying on of my hands. Undertake the commission. Go ahead and do it. Do not hold back. Take the step and do it. And a lot of times, we know what God has called us to. But sometimes you get caught up thinking, well, maybe this person can do it better. And I'm sure Timothy thought, well, I'm not very bold. How can I preach? How can I even lead a church? Can I just support the pastors without leading that church? And we should not allow fear. We should not allow anything to hinder us from undertaking what God has called us to do. We need to undertake. What is it that God has called you to do? This path that you have lived, for however long you have lived, do you know what it is that God has called you to do in this life? And have you begun undertaking it? Or are you still having that internal struggle, wondering, well, perhaps next year? Because at the end of time, you and I will stand before God and we will account for our lives. We will account for the gifts and the abilities that He's given us. And we all want to hear Him say, well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into your master's rest. So do not allow fear. Sometimes you allow fear. Sometimes you keep procrastinating. And you know how at the beginning of the year we set resolutions. So you say, this is the year. I'm going to do it this year. Then by June you're thinking, you're actually by early February forgotten what it is that you wanted to do. And then next year, the cycle goes on. Now I'd like to challenge us, stop setting resolutions. Stop writing them down if you're not going to do it. Decide in your heart, ask God to help you and undertake. The time to do it is now. The time to do what God has called you to do is now. So do not allow anybody to stop. Sometimes you look around and say, what will my family think? Some of us who have been called into ministry, but you think, oh, anything else, God, but not ministry. What will my family think? What will my friends say? Undertake the commission because God is your commanding officer. He's the one who has called you and you will stand before Him to account for that. We said that you need to undertake it and to be willing to endure suffering. That's what we see. Paul is a man who was accustomed to suffering, even as he tells Timothy that, hey, expect suffering. He says in verse 3, endure hardship with us like a good soldier of Christ Jesus. And he goes on to list, you know, the soldier and all these other people. Now, Paul is not saying something that he does not know. It is not theoretical for him. He is a man who was familiar with suffering. He had suffered. He had planted churches. He had been whipped. He had been beaten. He had been in prison. And even as we know, he writes this letter, like we've said, he was about to be executed. So he knew what suffering was. And he knew that it will not be easy. For you to live the purpose that God has called you to, it will not be easy. He made it very clear to Timothy that suffering was part of the deal, but that he had to endure it. He didn't want Timothy to have a wrong picture or to think that this is all, you know, it will be all bright and beautiful. That's what ministry is. He wanted Timothy to know from the get-go, there will be suffering, but you have to endure it. Timothy would face opposition in his ministry. He would have to deal with the false teachers, and that is for both the faith. And you see, in life it is easy to compromise, because none of us wants to suffer, right? Anybody here who says, well, bring it on, I don't mind suffering. None of us wants to suffer, but this is part of life. We must not allow the distractions of life to derail us from our goal. We must stay the course. A young couple in love and about to get married are very excited, you know, looking like Klein and Sharon here, you know, will be getting married next month. They are very excited, looking forward to the big day. And although there's all this excitement and there's the happily ever after that we see in Cinderella and all these other stories, they give vows. And in those vows, it says, for better, for worse, through the good times and the hard times. And this, my friends, means that hard times will come. Even with Mrs. Wright Glyde, or with Mr. Wright beside you, suffering will come, tough times will come. Such is life. This is the life that we live in. But this young couple in love commits that even when the hard times come, I will stay with you. I will still love you to the very end, till death do us part. And so we must also be willing to count the price and say, whatever comes in my life as I serve the Lord, I will stay the course, because I need to be faithful to the Lord who has called me. Praise the Lord. What will it cost you to remain faithful to God? What will it cost you to remain faithful to your family, to your calling? What is it that you need to do? Do not give up. Paul was willing to endure all kinds of suffering. And in 2 Corinthians 11 it says, are they servants of Christ? And he says, I am out of my mind to talk like this. I am more. I have worked much harder, been in prison more frequently, been flogged more severely, and been exposed to death again and again. 5 times I received from the Jews 40 lashes minus one. 3 times I was beaten with rods. Once I was pelted with stones. 3 times I was shipwrecked. I spent a night and a day in the open sea. I have been constantly on the move. I have been in danger from rivers, in danger from bandits, in danger from my fellow Jews, in danger from Gentiles, in danger in the city, in danger in the country, in danger at sea, and in danger from false believers. He's pretty much been in danger everywhere all the time. I have labored and toiled and have often gone without sleep. I have known hunger and thirst and have often gone without food. I have been cold and naked. Whew. I haven't gone through half of what he's gone through. So this is a man who's very familiar with suffering and with the cost that it takes for him to live the cost that he's been called for. On top of that, he's here writing this letter to his dear son when he's just about to be executed. Now, Paul gives us 7 pictures of faithful people that I want us to quickly look at. And the first image that we see in verse 2 is that of a steward. And a steward is one who is entrusted with something that they should give others. It is not somebody who receives something to keep. A steward is to be faithful. The second image we see is that of a soldier. We see this in verse 3 and 4 that says, and your hardship with us like a good soldier of Christ Jesus. No one serving as a soldier gets involved in civilian affairs. He wants to please his commanding officer. And the Christian life calls us to be soldiers. You know that song, I'm a soldier in the army. I'm a soldier. Have to practice. We have to practice. For us to become good believers, strong and mature believers, it doesn't happen when you just sit on your couch watching movies. You have to work hard at it. What do you put in? You have to put in a lot of work. Praise the name of the Lord.
Amen.
The third image you see is that of an athlete in verse 5. It says, similarly, if anyone competes as an athlete, he does not receive the victor's crown unless he competes according to the rules. An athlete must abide by the rules. There are rules to be obeyed. He must go through vigorous training through and through. And it takes continuous training for one to be a strong believer. It doesn't happen overnight. Some of us say, well, how do I pray? When you tell me to come and pray, I don't know. I know how to pray. I do my normal 5-minute prayer. But how do I pray for 10 minutes? How do I pray for half an hour? It takes practice, my brothers and sisters. And the more you practice, the better you become at it. How do I know the word of God? How come brother so-and-so wrote so many scriptures? How did you get them all in your mind? Practice. Praise the name of the Lord. Study the word of God. Memorize it. That's how you will know the will of God, isn't it? An athlete must abide by the rules. And without training, an athlete will go nowhere. What Paul was telling young Timothy is this, that the important thing is that you obey the word of God. No matter what people say, you are not running the race to please people or to get fame. You are running to please Jesus Christ. Our fourth image is of a farmer that we see in verse 6. It says the hardworking farmer should be the first to receive a share of the crops. I believe that farming is hard work, isn't it? Farming is hard work. And secondly, farming needs a lot of patience, isn't it? For those of us who farm, you have to be patient. For you to sow, to plow the land, to plant, to wait for the rains, it takes a lot of patience. Our fifth image is that of a workman, and we see this in verse 14. It says, keep reminding them of these things, warn them before God against quarreling about words. It is of no value, and only ruins those who listen. Verse 15 says, do your best to present yourself to God as one approved, as a workman who does not need to be ashamed, and who correctly handles the word of truth. Avoid godless chatter, because those who indulge in it will become more and more ungodly, and their teaching will spread like gangrene. Among them are Hymenaeus and Philetus, who have wandered away from the faith. The emphasis on the workman is that the workman needs to be diligent in his labor so that he will not be ashamed when his work is inspected. The enemy says, who correctly handles the word of God? A workman who correctly handles the word of truth in reference to Timothy as a pastor. Another version says, rightly dividing. And this basically means cutting straight. It can be applied to many different things, like plowing a straight line as a farmer. Cutting a straight seam if you're a tailor, or cutting a straight board. And Paul reminds Timothy that the pastor here, because you know that Timothy is a pastor, is a workman in God's word, and he must use the word of God correctly. There's all these doctrines going around. Use the word of God correctly to build the church. An approved worker diligently studies the word of God and seeks to apply it in his own life. Now the sixth image that we see of a faithful person is a vessel that we see in verse 20 to 23. It says, in a large house there are articles not only for gold and silver, but also of wood and clay. Some are for noble purposes and some for ignoble. If a man cleanses himself from the latter, he will be an instrument for noble purposes, made holy, useful to the master, and prepared to do any good work. And what Paul is saying here is, hey, there are people who are preaching the word correctly. Those are the vessels of honor. Then there are all these other ignoble vessels. Vessels of wood. And you have to separate yourself from these false teachers, Timothy. You must do whatever it takes you to be different. Because if you do this, then God will honor you. And God will set you apart and equip you for service. And for God to be able to use us as vessels, we must be empty. It says in verse 21, if a man cleanses himself from the latter, he will be an instrument for noble purposes, made holy and useful to the master. So we must be empty of all these entanglements that the world brings around us. We must be clean vessels And we must be available. If I have a pot here that I want to use to cook, but it is full of githeri, I cannot really have to empty it, but isn't it? I have to empty it and use it. So what is it that is filling you that you need to remove? What is it that you need to empty yourself of so that you can be a vessel of honor? You need to allow God to refine you so that you can become a person of honor both in your own life and in your doctrine. Image number 7 and last is that of a servant. You see this in verse 24 and 26. It says, and the Lord's servant must not quarrel. Instead, he must be kind to everyone, able to teach, not resentful. Those who oppose him, he must gently instruct in the hope that God will grant them repentance, leading them to a knowledge of the truth, and that they will come to their senses and escape from the trap of the devil who has taken them captive to do his will. So Timothy, as you serve the Lord, you must not quarrel. Do not get caught up trying to prove to these other people, well, I am the one who knows, this is what it says. Do not be caught up in that. Do not engage in that. Remember, as a vessel, you must be clean. And oftentimes when you engage in these other things, you're dirtifying yourself. And in the same manner, all of us are servants. And I want to tell us that serving is a lifestyle. And it is an attitude. What is your attitude? Somebody asked me, is it last week during our staff devotions? Somebody who was leading us said, well, if you say you're a servant, how is it that some people say they are servants of God, but then when you're treated like a servant, you take offense? So serving is a lifestyle, and it is an attitude. It should not be forced. It should be voluntary. Now, Paul in Romans 1 refers to himself as a servant. He says, I am a slave. The word servant actually in Greek is translated slave. And a slave had no rights. So Paul calls himself a slave to the Lord Jesus Christ. I am a slave to the word of God. God has called me to do this. And a slave has no will of his own. He has to totally obey the command of his master. In Romans 6 again, it says that once we Christians were slaves to sin, but now we are slaves to God. And so we need to understand that we are God's servants. And once we do that, then we will have no issues with serving God diligently and faithfully. Not just in church. I know that we keep encouraging us to serve in church, to serve in ministry, but in your own calling. Because whatever it is that you do, you're called to do it as unto the Lord. You're serving the Lord. If you see yourself as a doctor, that even as I see my patients, I am serving God. I have a master, not just your supervisor. But you have a master who is God, who's given you this ability, and that you will answer to him, then you have no issue with being faithful to your master. Praise the name of the Lord.
Amen.
We need to understand that we are masters. In whatever position or capacity that God has put us, we are servants. And our master is the Lord. We have our earthly masters, yes. But ultimately, I said, we will all stand before the Lord. It says in the parable of the talents, and he will say, okay, you, I gave you this, what have you done with it? What have you done with your life? What have you done with that call that he put in you, with the abilities that he gave you? We say, remember that they should not die with us. Praise the name of the Lord.
Amen.
So point number one was, how to be faithful was, understand your commission and pass it on to others. Number two, undertake it and be willing to endure persecution. Number three is, remember Christ or imitate Christ. How can we be faithful? Remember Christ. Paul tells Timothy in verse 8 to 13. He says, remember Jesus Christ, raised from the dead, descended from David. This is my gospel, for which I am suffering, even to the point of being chained like a criminal. He says, but God's word is not chained. Therefore, I endure everything for the sake of the elect. Remember Christ, because Christ is faithful through and through. Praise the name of the Lord. The nature of God is such that he is faithful. We say that when you look at the nature of something, it is not something that you put on. When you talk about God's nature, this is who he is in essence. He will not change. God does not put on faithfulness in the morning and says, now behold, I'm a faithful God. And then in the evening, he becomes something else. The essence of something does not change. It is who you are. So remember Jesus Christ, because he is faithful in his nature. In Philippians 2, we are called to emulate the example of Christ. Because Christ knew his mission, and he kept at it. He knew it would cost him a lot. He knew he had to suffer, to die, to save the world. But he kept at it. Being divine, Philippians says, he did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but he humbled himself to the point of death. That God who is eternal, God who is sovereign, became a man. I mean, for me, it keeps baffling me over and over again. And this is the highest form of humility, really, that we need to emulate. And then of servanthood, because Christ came to serve us. He did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many, as Mark tells us. He became a man. And that was, as if that was not enough, he died. Can you imagine that? God becoming like you to die for you. Isn't that amazing? So remember Christ, because he is faithful. He knew his mission. He kept at it to the very end. Halfway through, he didn't tell God the Father, well, these people are so stubborn. You know, I thought I would come and die for them, but can you devise another plan on how to save them? No. He knew that the mission was the cross. He had come to live and die, and he kept to it. It was not an easy assignment, but he kept it. And we too are called to imitate him. What is it that God has called you to do? Once again, I ask. What is it that should stop you from being faithful to God? If God has been this faithful to you, then we must do everything that we can to be faithful. Timothy had the example of Paul. We've talked about Paul a lot. He had the example of Paul to follow, because Paul had labored faithfully for the gospel. He had suffered physically for it. He had suffered harm for the gospel. And so Timothy had that example to follow. And greater than Paul is the Lord Jesus Christ, who is the perfect example for us to follow. Our faithfulness to God is an indicator of our faith in him. Praise the name of the Lord. Can I say that again? That our faithfulness to God is an indicator of our faith in him. Do you have faith in God? Be faithful. Be faithful. Praise the name of the Lord. Paul says in 2 Timothy chapter 4, which you'll look at in the last Sunday of this month, he says, now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but to all who have longed for his appearing. He was looking forward to his death. Can you see that? He was about to be executed, but he said, I have run the race. We all know Paul's famous last words. I have run the race. I have kept the faith. I have fought the good fight. And now it is up to you and I to keep the faith. Praise the Lord. May we run this race with endurance, so that we will be found faithful to the Lord. Because when we appear before him, we will give an account. He will ask, how did you live your life? I gave you life. I made you. I called you to do this. Is it a cause that God has put in your heart that you're supposed to support? And you keep saying, maybe God will bring somebody else. Maybe next month. Praise the name of the Lord. Serve the Lord your God with all your heart. Not just in ministry, but in that which he has called you to do. I'd like us to spend some time in prayer. And I want us to reflect on these things. What do you need to do to be faithful to God? God has called us to be faithful. And I believe that Timothy was faithful to his calling as a man of God and as a pastor, as a young pastor in difficult times in Ephesus. What changes do you need to make in your life in order to be faithful?